In this video, we will be discussing the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. To use this equation, we need to introduce the concept of the vapor pressure of a liquid. Molecules of a liquid will escape into the vapor phase at the surface, and it's this gas that's going to exert a pressure. Now, over time, the rate of molecules escaping into the vapor phase and the molecules recondensing into the liquid phase will reach an equilibrium. And at this equilibrium, we have reached our vapor pressure. Now, the Clausius-Clapeyron equation relates the vapor pressure of a liquid and its temperature. As you increase the temperature, then you are putting more of the liquid molecules into the vapor phase, and as you lower it, more are going to condense. Now, this equation comes in two forms. The form on the left, well, this is very useful in a laboratory setting. And the form on the right, well, we'll get to that one later. Now, it's very important to note that when doing these calculations that we use the correct gas constant, R, and that we use temperature in Kelvin. Now, let's take a look at that form of the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. If we rewrite it slightly, we move inverse temperature over a bit, we notice that this looks like the equation for a line. Natural log of pressure, that's our y. Negative enthalpy of vaporization divided by the gas constant, that's the slope. Inverse temperature is x, and the constant, the Clausius-Clapeyron constant, which is different for every gas, for every liquid and compound, that is our y-intercept. Well, if you graph natural log of vapor pressure versus inverse temperature in Kelvin, we get a nice straight line. And you can use this information to calculate the vapor pressure of some unknown liquid and determine its constant C. Now, what we want to do with the Clausius-Clapeyron equation is calculate, in this case, the vapor pressure at a new temperature, knowing the vapor pressure at another temperature. So for example, diethyl ether. We have determined that its vapor pressure at 18 degrees Celsius is 401 millimeters of mercury. Now, in order to calculate its vapor pressure at 32 degrees Celsius, we're going to need to know its enthalpy of vaporization. A lot of these we can look up. So we have our initial pressure, P1. We want to solve for P2. We have our initial temperature, needs to be converted to Kelvin. And we have our final temperature that we want to calculate P2 at. Now, the whole thing about enthalpy of vaporization, they are usually given to us in kilojoules per mole. However, the gas constant, in this case 8.31447 joules per Kelvin mole, well, the units are not the same. So you're going to have to convert one or the other. The most common is to convert enthalpy of vaporization to joules. So joules cancels joules. So all we have to do is plug all of this in. Be very careful. Make sure that you keep P1 and P2 and T1 and T2 straight. Otherwise, you're going to get a negative pressure, and we can't have that. So once we have everything plugged in, we need to solve for P2. Now, be very careful when performing these calculations. Notice we have a natural log in there. We're going to have to get rid of that, and any rounding error or intermediate rounding that's a little too short is going to cause problems down the line. It's going to be exacerbated when we get rid of that natural log by taking both sides to the anti-log. So, to get rid of natural log, we just take the anti-log. So the anti-log of the natural log of x is just x. And now we're going to go ahead and solve for P2. Now, you notice in the end, we started with millimeters of mercury, and we ended with millimeters of mercury. Everything else is canceled out. Now, let's take a look at this. As we increased temperature, we increased the vapor pressure of diethyl ether, which makes sense. Now, let's talk a bit about the boiling point of a liquid. Here we have a chart of diethyl ether, ethyl alcohol, water, and ethylene glycol. Now, as we increase the temperature, the vapor pressure of all these liquids goes up. Now you notice here at about 101 kilopascals, which just happens to be one atmosphere of pressure, where these lines cross 101 kilopascals, well, that looks very familiar, especially for water. So at 100 degrees, the vapor pressure of water equals standard atmospheric pressure. And that is basically the definition of the boiling point. Boiling point is the temperature at which the vapor pressure of the liquid equals atmospheric pressure. So, for instance, let's find the normal boiling point of an unknown liquid that has a vapor pressure of 0.302 atmospheres at 25 degrees Celsius and an enthalpy of vaporization of 32 kilojoules per mole. So in this case, instead of solving for pressure, we're actually trying to find the normal boiling point. Normal boiling point is the boiling point at atmospheric pressure. So we have our initial pressure. Our final pressure is going to be one atmosphere. That's what we want our vapor pressure to equal. We have our initial temperature, and we need to solve for our final temperature. Enthalpy of vaporization, go ahead and convert that to kilojoules per, go ahead and convert that to joules per mole. And then finally, our gas constant. Make sure you're using the right gas constant. We're talking about energy here, so we need to use the gas constant that involves the energy unit joules. Plug everything in, and now we can solve for T2. Again, very careful that you don't mix up T1 and T2, otherwise you're going to get a negative answer. Which in this case, a negative temperature in Kelvin isn't going to happen. Now once we've simplified the equation a little bit, let's solve for T2. Very careful with your algebra at this point. And if we take a look at the units, we notice that so far we have units of inverse Kelvin. All right. So if we need to solve for T2 here, we need to take the inverse of both sides. Now, your initial answer is going to be in Kelvin. It's sometimes useful to convert that to Celsius, but only if you're asked to. So this makes sense that if we want to raise the vapor pressure from 0.302 atmospheres to 1 atmosphere, we're going to have to increase the temperature from 25 degrees to 55.5 degrees Celsius.